Extinction! Extinction! Extinction!
Rebellion!
Extinction!
Rebellion!
Extinction!
Rebellion!
And we're sitting here in solidarity also with the people near Doncaster, Fish Lake, all these people who are still mopping up. They're going to be spending years recovering from a disaster which is going to affect us all. We are all of us going to be suffering more. And it's no good just building higher defences. The sea, the rivers, the rain, extreme weather, they are going to catch us out. We need to be thinking right now that food shortages are already happening in most vast areas of the global south are already in despair. And what are we doing? We are morally paralyzed. We're just doing nothing. We need to stand up. And we've got wonderful, brave people here, standing up, dressing up, being cheerful, talking about a better world, a world which is not based on profit, but a world that's based on people, a local world, a Sheffield world. Why not? Why can't we have a Sheffield that we're proud of, full of trees and children playing in the streets, and no cars, and us talking to each other instead of competing all the time. Hey ho, come on everybody, we're doing the right thing.
Not even a generation. This could be one in a lifetime opportunity to make a difference. One in 100 years. We don't act now. It worries me that what we'll be doing then is quite literally firefighting. You know, the people in Brazil, people in Africa, people in Australia, they're fighting the fires. I don't want to do that. I want to be boring scientists at home working on research and helping kill poverty and producing things that are more energy efficient. That's what I do. I don't stand out here talking to fantastic men and women about how we're going to save the planet. That should be just something we do. Why don't we just do that? And then get on with the hard bit. This should be the easy thing. Sorry, I'm getting quite emotional now. But, you know, well, how is it that Extinction Rebellion are seemingly the bad guys? Because we remind people how bad it's going to be in the future. And we don't want that future. We want a different future. We want a future that is shiny. We want a future where people are free and have education and healthcare. And not have to be scared of the future. Can we try that? How about we just try that as an option?
We need the government to act. And we're asking that they halt, help us to halt through policies, the biodiversity loss, and to reduce greenhouse gases to net zero by 2025. At the moment, our government is planning to reach carbon zero by 2050. And yet, the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change has already stated very clearly that we only have 10 years maximum at the most, to change our track. And to make sure that we allow ourselves and all life on Earth a future. 2050 is too late. Extinction Rebellion are asking that we become carbon neutral by 2025 as a matter of urgency. When you are voting out there, please bear in mind that if we do not reach carbon zero, zero by much sooner than our current government intends, we are not going to survive. Our planet is already running into a spiral of runaway climate change. We cannot afford to let this happen. We need to wake up, we need to work together, and we need to stop this madness.
Going to deliver a talk today from the Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres. But before, things are really bad. We are all angry with each other. We want to be listened to. Some of us want Brexit, and we wanted it a year ago. Some of us don't want Brexit. And we want a referendum now. We want our schools to be better. We want our NHS to be better. We don't trust our politicians. We don't trust our media. We have even lost trust in our scientists. We are angry and distrustful. And so in this election, we're going to show those we think have let us down how we feel, regardless of who that hurts, including ourselves. But stop. Wait a minute. Things are really bad. We must not do that. To do so will be letting down all future generations. It will be to threaten the well-being and even lives of those who love most, our children and their children. We are facing an unprecedented crisis. The threat to humanity that threatens our lives, the lives of millions of species on this planet. A threat so severe that it will be determined in the next year, next 10 years, unless we do something now. We are facing a climate crisis that threatens our lives, our civilizations, our societies, and even the future of our species. This threat has been known for 40 years, but our leaders have done absolutely nothing about it. Our oceans are warming and rising. Sea life is becoming extinct. Our ice is melting from the poles to the mountain glaciers. Our forests are being burnt down from the Amazon to the Arctic Circle, and our rivers are bursting their banks. Our winters are wetter than ever. Our summers are hotter than ever. Our crops are desiccating in the fields in summer and unable to be sown into waterlogged ground in the winter. Species are becoming extinct at the rate of one every 10 minutes. And large areas of the globe will soon be incompatible with human life. And so people will be forced to move, and they will be stopped by walls, and security forces with unprecedented powers. Our economies will be unable to sustain the costs. That is the bleak future that we in XR are predicting, and that is why we are out on the streets and demanding that the government act now. So yes, things are really bad. And we kind of know that, don't we?
Yes.
But we are an angry nation. We have been let down. We don't trust anyone, and we think maybe all of this could just be another hoax. Perhaps it's just an attempt to make us ordinary people pay more. We are used to that. We are angry. We don't believe you, and you are lying to us. I don't know how to convince you that this is real. I am not an expert, but I trained in the National Health Service, and I found something beautiful in the objectivity of science. Science is a discipline which looks for evidence to prove or disprove a hypothesis, and it does that and it tests it for statistical significance. But it goes further than that. It subjects every single finding to review by other scientists to see if they come to the same conclusions. And all around 30 meters of A4 printed pages are the citations of research articles that have been used to produce the 2018 IPCC report, which states that we have to tackle the climate and ecological emergencies right now for the very survival of humanity. 113 pages of fine print references, 6,000 research articles, each one peer-reviewed, each one sent up to be reviewed by intergovernmental IPCC scientists, 91 full-time scientists working for the IPCC reviewing each paper, and 97% of all climate scientists support the findings. The governments of every United Nations nations have needed to agree those findings, and only then can the IPCC make a statement. And so those filters are absolutely huge. The statement has been made by that most conservative of processes, and yet it could be not more radical and strong. And it's for this reason that I want to read the statement made by the United Nations Secretary General to the COP25 on Monday of this week. I don't think there is any more compelling authority to produce any more compelling reason for each and every one of us to make the climate and environment the number one issue when we vote on Thursday. I'm going to read the speech in full. There are some things that we in XR may want to be said differently, but what he is saying is almost exactly what we are saying. We are facing a crisis, an emergency of unparalleled significance for humanity. We need to act now. So listen to this statement. People of Sheffield, listen to this statement. Open your hearts to the words of the United Nations Secretary General. Think about your children. Cast your eyes over these vast numbers of references and reports that have led to the statement. Things are really bad, and we know that we should act. We must act. We will act. Please vote for the climate on Thursday.
Not disrupting anyone's day, not blocking any roads, inviting conversation on this serious matter, making sure that this is the number one issue when people go to the polls on Thursday. This is the climate election. We cannot afford for it to be anything but the climate election. Our next special guest speaker is Jim Diamond from Save Our Green Open Space, a campaign focusing on protecting the limited green open space we all still have in this city, the Sheffield Central Cemetery, welcome Jim Diamond.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Peter, for inviting me. I'm gonna start with a story. One of the things that I do is I teach English. I'm a voluntary teacher, and I teach English to speakers of other languages, mainly refugees and asylum seekers. So, of course, many of the people that I'm teaching are here because they're fleeing war in their countries. But I think we need to be under no illusions that future waves of migrants will be coming to this country because they're fleeing and they're looking for water, for food, and for other resources. So one of my students is a lady in her mid-30s. She's from the countryside outside Chennai in southern India. And she was telling me that when she was a teenager, 20 odd years ago, there were lots of trees and birds and animals in the countryside. And the summers were hot, 35 degrees centigrade, but that was normal. And there was plenty of food and work to go round. When she returned to her country to visit her family earlier this year, she found that many things had changed. There were very few trees. Many of them had been cut down to make way for telephone masts. There was no bird song like there was in her childhood. There were very few trees and no animals left in the nearby to where she lives. She found that crops were failing. The summers were now regularly reaching temperatures of 45 to 50 degrees centigrade. There were many farmers in the countryside committing suicide because their crops were failing, and people were fleeing the countryside to go and live in Chennai in search of food and for jobs. Now, the effects of climate change are just as real in Sheffield, and if we're not careful, will be just as dramatic. That's why all of us need to protect our environment. So I'm encouraged to see that there are so many of you here today, so many like-minded people, especially the young ones from Extinction Rebellion, prepared to stand up for what they believe in, even when those who are supposed to be representing our best interests aren't doing so on our behalf. So I've come here today as a spokesman for Save Our Green Open Space, or SOGOS for short. SOGOS was set up 18 months ago to try and make sure that the Sheffield General Cemetery was protected as a calm oasis of peace and a little green space as in the city, not just for us but for future generations. Sheffield General Cemetery is the local nature reserve. And it's in a conservation area, so it's a really important space. You might ask, why is this important to me? Well, I feel lucky to have lived opposite the General Cemetery Park for 18 years, and it's a privilege for me to see birds and bats and owls and badgers regularly. It's a beautiful spot, it's wild and it's overgrown and it's atmospheric. It's Sheffield's equivalent of Highgate Cemetery in London, and it ought to be preserved and cherished as such. But unfortunately, our council has a poor record of protecting our green spaces and our heritage. Despite that, I was pleased to hear that Sheffield Council have been awarded £3.7 million of heritage lottery funding to pay for renovations and repairs, and to make the cemetery safe and to increase its use in the local community. So what actually happened? SOGOS started to campaign really to raise awareness of the council's plans to install a 14-space pay-and-display car park inside Sheffield General Cemetery. And I, alongside many like-minded residents, were 100% against those plans. So we raised money, we printed leaflets, and we held public events and started a petition against the car park, and we spoke to local people. It's important to remember that Sheffield General Cemetery was granted to the people of Sheffield by an Act of Parliament in 1980. So the green space that's there actually belongs to all of us. It's our space. So we generated lots of publicity. We went to council meetings and we asked awkward questions. And when we didn't get proper answers to those questions, we asked even more awkward questions under using the Freedom of Information Act. We made the council understand that we weren't going to give up without a fight. We got almost 1,500 signatures on our petition, and we made it very clear that many of us were and still are prepared to stand up in front of bulldozers and to take non-violent direct action to force them to take notice. So what was the result? Well, I think the council realised that we were serious and that they couldn't ignore us any longer. We made them understand that we will resist any building work going on in the area around the car park, where there are going to be 15,000 new residents, which meant that every single inch of green space inside that cemetery was very important to the people of Sharrow. Recently, we've seen a change of approach from the council, and I'm glad to tell you that SOGOS has been invited by them to sit on the whole site management group overseeing plans for the General Cemetery Development Project. So we're working constructively and in partnership with the council now. We're making sure that they engage seriously with local people and that local people are consulted. We're actually helping them to do their job better. So the plans for a 14 space car park have actually been scaled back dramatically. It seems that we may actually have won this battle, and I'm cautiously optimistic, although of course it is the council's final decision. They reserve the right to make the final decision on their plans. So what lessons have we learned, and how is this relevant to why all of you are here today? Well, it's important to understand that we mustn't take no for an answer. We must make government, whether it's local government or national governments or internationally, make them take notice of us and don't let them ignore us. It's important to build alliances across campaigns. And we in SOGOS recognised early on that there were parallels between our campaign and the Sheffield Street Trees campaign. A healthy street tree is important and does the same job, whether it's inside a cemetery wall or alongside polluted roads. I think the second point is to remember that it's our city. I'm not just referring to the campaign to bring more local democracy to Sheffield, but also the fact that this town does literally belong to us. Local councils and councillors come and go, and they should remember that they're working for us. It's us who pay their wages, and they're supposed to be protecting our city and our environment and our streets, and not privatising them, and protecting our green spaces for us and for future generations, especially for young people. So before I finish, I'd just like to remind you of my student from rural Chennai. She spoke about phone masts going up, replacing trees, and about mobile phones exploding because of the heat waves that they now experience regularly each summer in southern India. Well, here in Sheffield, I'm proud to say that we've saved many of our street trees from the chop, but we need to do much more. We know that insect species, for example, are in collapse, and I've noticed fewer birds where I live, and that their behaviour, especially the times of day that they sing, has been changed following the introduction of the new LED street lamps. We need more events like this. We need more people prepared to stand up and take direct action. And we need to say loudly and clearly that this city is ours and this future is ours. Thank you for listening.
Such a hard time. is an emergency. The waters are all rising, and so we have to rise up now, or we will soon be drowning. I'm sorry, my friend,
we have to rise up.